On today's episode, we'll be talking about China and the Hong Kong protests from the perspective of a former Chinese national and why, as Americans, we must stand with Hong Kong. Hi guys, Lisa Smiley here. Thank you so much for joining me on my very first episode of Pod and Country, a weekly podcast / video show produced by The Daily Caller. I'm your host, Lisa Smiley. Now, before I forget, let me remind you to subscribe to our channel and hit the bell to get notified of any new content. With the 2020 election coming up, you won't want to miss all of our great content to keep you informed and to give you a few laughs about all the crazy stuff the Democrats are saying. Now, a little bit about me. If you are watching this, you will notice that, yes, I am Asian. Chinese to be specific, but then I talk with this weird accent. Is that confusing you? I know I get weird looks all the time. Let me explain. I was born in China. I am ethnically Chinese, but at the age of 4, my parents moved us to New Zealand, which is where I grew up, and hence the accent. So please don't tell me I sound like an Australian, because that's insulting to my Kiwi sensibilities. Just kidding, my older sister now lives in Sydney, Australia, for any Aussies who may be watching. So I guess you could say I grew up in Middle Earth, frolicking in the Shire without a care in the world. But alas, that was not the end. Right after high school, my parents moved us to America. Now, I had never been to America at that point, but all my relatives here raved about it incessantly on the phone. And I thought, oh man, my American relatives are just a little bit too prideful and patriotic about their country. Well, look at me now. I've become just like them. I stepped off the plane at LAX, and despite all the craziness of being an immigrant and rebuilding our lives here, it felt like home. And I've been here ever since. I graduated from UC Irvine in California with a degree in philosophy. So I really like to talk about ideas, especially political ideas, and that's why I got into politics. So I've lived on 3 different continents under 3 different political systems, and I've been an immigrant twice, both times legally. So please don't tell me to go back to my own country, because China won't take me back, and I've become an American citizen. I am now your fellow countrywoman. Thank you. Okay, so that's me. Now let's get back to the subject at hand. So China's been in the news quite a lot lately. I thought it was fitting to begin my show talking about the situation between China and Hong Kong. And for those of you who may think I may be misinformed or uneducated on the subject, I have some personal stories I will share about living in communist China myself. So the Hong Kong residents have been protesting in the streets for months now. But how did this conflict begin? Well, if you remember, it started last summer when legislation was proposed that would allow the Hong Kong people to be extradited to the mainland. Now, on the outset, it doesn't seem like a big deal, right? Well, the people of Hong Kong saw it differently. They saw it as the last straw. For years now, the central government of China has been stripping away the rights of the Hong Kong citizens. In response to this, the pro-democracy protests began. The Hong Kongers took to the streets to protest this bill and also to fight for the freedom that they were promised in an international treaty between China and Britain. More about that in a minute. Now, the footage of these protests is nothing short of incredible. 2 million people marching in the streets. That's a quarter of the population of Hong Kong. And while the bill has since been scrapped, the protests continue. The conflict between China and Hong Kong, I think, has only begun. So who are the Hong Kong protesters up against? And why are they pleading for America's support? The Chinese Communist Party, which, by the way, just celebrated 70 years of being in power in early October. Now, to really understand the nature of the CCP and just what the Hong Kong protesters are up against, Let's take a moment to remember the accomplishments of the Communist Party, shall we? According to this wonderful scholarly book, The Black Book of Communism, printed by Harvard University Press, the party is responsible for 65 million total deaths. Tragedies include the Great Leap Forward in 1958, which sought to change China from an agrarian culture to a socialist one. And so to achieve its socialist utopia, the country went through rapid industrialization. They collectivized the farmland. And dissenters were either executed or sent to labor camps. And these leftist policies only led to disaster. In fact, it led to the greatest famine in history, killing tens of millions of the Chinese between 1959 and 1961. Then Chairman Mao launched his Cultural Revolution. Its goal? To rid the country of any remaining remnants of capitalism and tradition. Again, total disaster. It only damaged the economy even more and led to the deaths of 500,000 to 2 million people. Now, my own parents experienced these events. My dad has told us stories about how when he was little, he went through periods of starvation, and he would save any little morsel of food he had so that he could share it with his other starving siblings. He's told us that living in communist China was absolutely terrible. When they went to school, they were encouraged to rat out their parents if they disagreed with the government's policies. So no one trusted each other. And then on my mum's side, they were considered wealthy, and so their property was confiscated. And of course, who can forget the one-child policy? According to the Chinese government, it has prevented 400 million babies from being born and led to the total breakdown of the family structure. This is China's war against women and girls. Women are subject to forced sterilization and forced abortion at the hands of the government's family planning agency. Well, I can speak from experience. I was born there. From these photos, it looks like we lived in a third world country. Well, that's because we did. Life in China in the 80s when I was born was very primitive. What's weird about these photos? Well, in most Chinese families, there's usually only one, maybe two kids. Well, funny that my parents defied the Chinese government in order to bring me into the world. I am one of five daughters in my family, and the youngest three, including myself, were born illegally after the one-child policy became law. They, like most Chinese families, did want a son. But they kept on having daughters, five of them. But despite the law and what the culture was telling them, they actually had really strong family values. And they didn't want to abort or kill any of us, even though it was happening around them. So when my mom became pregnant with me, she traveled to the city by herself to stay with a relative, scared and hoping that the government officials wouldn't find her out and force her to abort. And then when her due date approached, she traveled to another city to give birth to me before it was safe to return to our village. And they continued to hide us when the government officials came checking on families. Thankfully, we were able to get out. My family moved out of China in 1989, also during an incredibly tense political time. It was during the Tiananmen Square demonstrations. Now, by the grace of God, we left the country right before the situation in Beijing escalated. My dad had actually already left for New Zealand in order to prepare a new life for us there. And so my mom was traveling as the only adult with five girls, ages 11, 9, 6, 4, that was me, and 2. And because of the political unrest happening up north, she was terrified that they wouldn't let her cross the border into Hong Kong to leave. But thankfully, they did. We stayed in Hong Kong for about a week. And I don't really remember much about Hong Kong since it was only 4. But I do remember that it was completely different from the mainland. It was really busy. People were everywhere. Stores were everywhere. And they seemed happy and free. It just felt a lot more lighthearted. And it was a lot more technologically advanced. And then after a week or so, we got on our flight to New Zealand and never looked back. Ironically, this year also marks the 30th anniversary of the Tiananmen Square massacre. If you will remember, the Chinese Communist Party sent tanks to stamp out the pro-democracy protests led by students in Beijing. Now, these Hong Kong protests, which are led by a huge number of young people, harken back to those events. So let's pray it doesn't end with the same result. A China expert, Ruiji Littlejohn, who is the president of Women's Rights Without Frontiers, has said, quote, "Today, Tiananmen Square could never have happened because China has no freedom of assembly. People cannot gather on the square. If just two people were to gather and hold up a sign, they will be detained immediately. 30 years later, we see that human rights in China have not improved but deteriorated." Indeed, she is right. Since the 80s when we left, China, of course, has made sweeping economic advances. It has become the second largest economy in the world and has lifted millions of its citizens out of poverty. But did this transfer to improvements in civil liberties? No. In fact, advances in technology and greater efficiency has only helped the party's totalitarian rulership over its people. We're talking a social credit system, surveillance cameras are everywhere, they have facial recognition. Don't think you can hide from the big brother commies. Communication on phones and over the internet is also monitored by the government. And it's been described as living in an open-air prison. China or North Korea? I don't know who wins the prize for being the top human rights abuser at this point. According to the recent Congressional Executive Commission on China, it reported that 1 million Uyghur Muslims are in political re-education concentration camps. China does not allow the freedom of press. It exerts total control and censorship over the media. Journalists and political dissidents are jailed or executed, and President Xi Jinping has abolished term limits, essentially making him president for life. The underground church has experienced unprecedented persecution, where pastors and priests are jailed, and churches have been bulldozed to the ground. And the list goes on. So this is the regime the Hong Kong people are up against. So how has Hong Kong been spared of such brutality? And how is Hong Kong different from China? Well, the population is made up of 92% Chinese, but Hong Kong was of course a British colony for 150 years up until 1997. The reason the Hong Kongers have tasted freedom is because of British colonization. Oh, those evil white British colonizers had the nerve to give Hong Kong a taste of freedom and democracy. The Hong Kong people were granted freedoms like the freedom of speech, of the press and of publication, the freedom of association, of assembly, demonstration, and the freedom of religion, etc. Britain imported Western values to this tiny place in Asia, the same values that founded this nation, by the way. And that is the very reason, the only reason, why Hong Kong has flourished for all these years. That's the power of political ideas. Bondage in the mainland versus freedom in Hong Kong, thanks to Britain. However, in 1997, control of Hong Kong was, of course, handed back to China. In an international treaty, the Sino-British Joint Declaration, China agreed to implement a one country, two systems principle for 50 years. It would allow Hong Kong to be governed as before. Socialism practiced on the mainland would not be imposed on Hong Kong, and Hong Kong could continue practicing capitalism, and the residents would maintain their Western freedoms. Well, making deals with totalitarian governments don't seem to work out well. China has not been upholding its end of the deal. The Hong Kong people have watched as China has stripped away their rights over the years. Back in August, Marco Rubio tweeted out, "China's escalating threats against Hong Kong is not an internal matter. It's a blatant violation of commitment to Hong Kong's autonomy Beijing made in an international treaty. And given their history of repression, Chinese troops massed on border is cause for grave concern. The Hong Kong people are not willing to give over their freedoms to the Communist Party without a fight." You see, under the British style of government, Hong Kong has achieved unbelievable success and freedom. People have flocked to Hong Kong, despite the fact that it has the most expensive real estate in the world. It has a booming economy with an established financial market, which I just read that it's actually starting to go into recession, no thanks to the political unrest right now. It's ranked near the top of Heritage Foundation's Economic Freedom Index, and it's a place of industry. Life expectancy is one of the highest in the world, and it has developed its culture. It gave rise to Cantopop, which I grew up listening to, and other cultural icons and entertainment products. While the people in the mainland languish under the Communist Party, Hong Kong represents freedom. The Chinese were given a chance at self-government within Hong Kong's borders and found freedom to pursue their own happiness. All that is at stake, says pro-democracy leader Jimmy Lai. Lai has been involved in promoting democracy in China and Hong Kong for years now. Because of his work, he's been a victim of an assassination attempt, his home has been firebombed, his family harassed, and his businesses threatened by the Communist Party. A spirit of martyrdom runs through these protest leaders, who are willing to die to fight for their freedom. Now, Jimmy Lai was just interviewed at Uncommon Knowledge at the Hoover Institution, and I encourage you to listen to his full testimony. He believes that the Chinese Communist Party wants to turn Hong Kong into just another city under its complete control. I stand with Hong Kong because I know personally what it's capable of. Utter evil. Well, how has the Communist Party responded? Typical of totalitarian regimes throughout history. The Hill reported Chinese President Xi Jinping cautioned that any effort to split with China will result in bodies smashed and bones ground to powder. He sounds like a wonderful president to live under. The House of Representatives recently passed the Hong Kong Human Rights and Democracy Act to support Hong Kong. It was approved unanimously. In response, the Washington Post reported, China slams arrogant and dangerous U.S. over Hong Kong democracy bill as the city's dysfunction deepens. In regards to the bill, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi said, "The extraordinary outpouring of courage from the people of Hong Kong stands in stark contrast to the cowardly government that refuses to respect the rule of law and live up to the one country, two systems framework, which was guaranteed more than two decades ago." Thank you, Nancy Pelosi. One of the few times I agree with you. Well, China sure isn't happy about that. Nonetheless, it seems that the NBA and Hollywood are still willing to turn a blind eye to perhaps the greatest mass murderer in history. And for what? The authoritarian hush money. China, I think, knows its economic power in the world. China has no qualms about punishing Americans or American companies which dare to speak up for Hong Kong. China believes that it's become so powerful that it had the nerve to tell the NBA to fire a general manager. And it seems some NBA players were willing to bend to the Communist Party. But it's not just the NBA controversy of late. Hollywood has been editing and censoring its films for years now. In order to get the films into the huge Chinese consumer market, it has to get the approval of the Chinese government. And nothing released to the Chinese people can ever make the commies look bad. Sorry if I can't take the NBA, Hollywood, or any of these woke celebrities seriously. When they lecture us about how evil, racist, and imperialist America is, when they won't even call out China on their myriad abuses of human rights. Talk about a double standard, and talk about being total hypocrites and cowards. For goodness sakes, 1 million Uyghur Muslims are in concentration camps right now. Political dissidents are executed. And Hong Kong is losing its freedom, it's become a police state, and its citizens are being stripped of their civil rights. For example, Hong Kong citizen Joshua Wong tweeted out, "I become the only candidate banned from running in November's district council election as returning officer. Laura Aron ruled my nomination invalid this morning. It proved how Beijing manipulates the election with political censorship and screening. Free elections? No. Beijing is pulling the strings. And look, Donald Trump isn't putting his political opponents in concentration camps, nor is he jailing journalists. America is the most free, most generous, least racist country in the world. And I speak from experience. China? Not so much. And here's the thing. The Hong Kong protesters aren't asking America to send in tanks to take out the Chinese government. They're merely asking for our moral support, our vocal support, for the international outrage to be loud enough to force China to let Hong Kong have its promised freedom. They're holding up our flag at these demonstrations as a symbol of the freedom that they're fighting for. They want what we have, and perhaps what we take for granted. Now, I really hate how China is telling us what we can and cannot say. Newsflash, we're in America. We have the freedom of speech. And why are we self-censoring to appease a communist regime? Who's the superpower again? And for those of you who may think that this doesn't really concern us, well, I'm not so sure. As China's economic power has grown, it has only emboldened it militarily. China has no intentions to shed its communist past. Quite the contrary. It's now become an international threat to us. China would be more than happy to impose on its neighbors and even on America its values. As Secretary Pompeo has said, we must engage China as it is, not as we wish it to be. We cannot appease China. China will only respond to power and force. So let's keep the pressure on China to let Hong Kong be free. Hong Kong will lose its freedom if we don't speak out now. And that is why I stand with Hong Kong and everything that the protesters are fighting for. So let's keep Hong Kong in our prayers. Okay, well, that's all we have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me on the very first episode of Pod and Country. If you enjoyed the show, please subscribe and come back next week for another episode. We'll be covering lots of different topics in politics, culture, and faith. You can follow me on Twitter at Lisa S. Smiley. You can also write to me at lisa@dailycaller.com. I'd appreciate your constructive feedback. Thanks, and see you next time.